قسما بالله رب العالمين ما ارتضينا غير دين الله دين فهو دين الحق دين الأنبياء إنه الإسلام نور وضياء
هذا الدر وهذه الكلم بمديح الهادي تنتظم ضاءت بالمختار الظلم وحلا في مولده النغم.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Welcome today to this special episode of Finding Me on the ITV Networks as we celebrate Women's Day. You know, funnily enough, as I left the house this morning, my husband said to me, you can see it's Women's Day. Look at the weather. It's cloudy, it's overcast, and it's cold. Very unpredictable, just like women. But I think it also shows the spiraling and the dynamic nature of women and also the ability to transition. So with that, I have a very special guest with me, a wonderful colleague, an exceptional human being. I would like to welcome Alfred Rantsho Moraka, who is a PhD student at the University of Pretoria in the Faculty of Law, where his speciality is in literature, law and gender. With that, thank you, Alfred, for making this time and for sharing your ideas always with me.
Thank you so much, Grace. I'm delighted to be here, and I would have crossed seven seas to come and contribute to what you are doing and the critical journalism and just being a crusader for consciousness raising. So a big pat on the shoulder for your ceaseless work.
Thank you, Alfred. And I think it could not be possible without all the knowledge that I have got from you and the various colleagues that I have featured on the show. Because it's Women's Day today, I would like to just start with the issue of gender and then come into the more important, or I shouldn't say more important, gender is always important, yeah. but the different discussion, which is on the African posture, reimagining the African posture in terms of the decolonial narrative. But let's start with gender. You consider the whole idea of gender within a colonial viewpoint?
Absolutely, absolutely. There's been a emerging critical work, particularly from a scholar, a Nigerian scholar called Oyeronke Ewume, who has really questioned the place of gender in African society. You know, through her research, she's able to show in really compelling ways the way that African life was organized pre-colonial Africa did not make sense that gender was an organizing principle. So for her, on the eve of colonialism, you could not even legibly use the word woman to describe anything. That's how deep the equality was. I was watching a YouTube video the other day, and they were saying that the Egyptians were the most gender equal society. Instead of saying they were not a genderless society, you know, the equality precisely dissipated even the very idea of gender. And we cannot understand those society using the framework and schema of gender that we find ourselves here. Now, this is not just a hollow claim that she makes. You know, she studies specific sites at which we can see the absence of gender. She studies the polyspiritual practices of African culture. So she looks at the fact that we believe in ancestors who are genderless and not the father, the son, which are gendered beings. She looks at the structure of our languages and the absence of gender pronouns, so that grammar and everyday communication does not rely on being able to identify somebody by a pronoun. She looks at aesthetic practices, the way that we wear our clothing. You know, some Western whites, when they go to Nigeria, say, accuse Nigerian men of wearing dresses,
yes,
instead
exactly.
of captains. So you can see that they're imposing and writing in gender to understand a society that doesn't have it, you know. So Oyeronke insists that the first success of colonialism was the invention of women into the Yoruba society, which she specifically studies and then implicates the whole African continent in that schema. And she insists that gender was simply not an organizing principle of African culture.
So by introducing this whole principle of gender into the African society, mm-hmm. and especially the notion of woman, was that also in a way the same kind of a tactic of a divide and rule, where you start creating hierarchies and you start dismantling the society?
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, the opening of a book specifically discusses the hierarchy of whites over blacks, of men over women, that this drive to categorize and organize society along values of who is more and who is less, merely by how they appear, is precisely the problem for her. And it's so interesting you should mention that, because she says the reason why white people created gender is because they are a society that is visually orientated, whereby African society are auditory, oral-based cultures, which means what is heard is far more important than what is seen. We see in the tradition of Western philosophy the idea that seeing is believing, you know, the idea that sight, that one must come into enlightenment. So sight is so central to the understanding and making to the understanding of the phenomenon of existence, that they had to look at somebody and extrapolate meaning from just looking at that person. So when they speak about a worldview, they're really speaking about the viewing, that people are always on display on viewing, where Oyoronge suggests that we should look for a world sense, that is to incorporate how we see, how we feel, how we imagine, what we taste, that all of that come together to give an account of the world. And yeah.
Sorry, no, I just want to stop you there, because I think that's very, very interesting. Mm-hmm. Because from a journalistic point of view, when you speak about a worldview, mm-hmm. and in the way in which you have just described it now, it's actually very censored.
Absolutely.
And if you look at the preoccupation with media and entertainment,
absolutely.
In which to shape this particular worldview, now you begin to understand how the world is seen and how the world is perceived.
Absolutely.
Through this vision, because the creation of this other, the language is so mediocre. If you look at entertainment today,
absolutely,
there isn't that sense, that depth, that understanding, like, for example, in the African culture or even in the Muslim world, mm. language was important. Words had meaning, and meaning accounted for so much.
Absolutely.
But today, throughout, I've been tracing language, a lot of it in the Western culture, mm. and the euphemisms and the use of soft language has become very phenomenal, in the sense that it is a form of erasure as well.
Absolutely.
To hide very many things.
Yeah.
So this makes sense.
Absolutely, it definitely makes sense, and I'm glad that you bring the issue of entertainment into the play, because if you and the emphasis on how people look on their bodies, you know, and this also affects women, because they suffer in the entertainment industry much more deeper pressures of appearance than this. If we were to study the aesthetic and ritualistic practice of African culture, they relied on precisely the stylization of the body, on wearing exuberant masks and colors, on coloring the body. So the body had a much more expensive meaning than what people wore. And so we wore masks and we wore bright colors and we disorientated the body, so that the body was not central to the expression. It was the music, it was the rhythm, it was the bringing of color, it was the choreography of dance. So the emphasis was on the experience of sound, on the experience of movement, rather than on the emphasis on how somebody looks, and therefore extrapolating meaning from that. You know?
So it was the creative expression of the individual, isn't
creative
it?
Creative flow, creative
yes.
expression.
Psychological, emotional, psychic,
spiritual,
everything
and,
together.
And so
yeah.
on.
Yeah.
And also, to the extent that it's Women's Day, we might even want to reflect on the fact that the kinship organization of the Yoruba society and of all African societies, really, was that a woman, if they were to go into congress with a male, did not inherit the property. And Western feminists have interpreted that as a gender regressive thing. But understand, in African culture, there's no ownership over property. And secondly, if there is any property to be shared, you inherit from your siblings. Your husband inherits from the siblings, and you inherit from your siblings. So African culture understood congresses between two people, what we today call marriages, they understood as the bringing together of family. You are not unhinged from your family and now living in a nuclear family, and now whatever you accumulate is divided between two people. Your role, your ethical responsibility, your connection to the people, what they call your womb people, the people whom you come from the same womb with, remains even as you expand and enter into other families and so on. And so the idea, women actually suffer more under the idea of inheritance under husband, rather than inheriting from the siblings and from the family kinship from which they come from. And also the woman was not understood as a special category in that sense. So for instance, look at motherhood. It might be an issue that we struggle with in the world today regarding the rights of moms and so on. And in African culture, motherhood is an ethical role and category. It is not gender-based, and it does not require a biological process of affirmation. So for instance, in my language, Setswana, you have mama, which is your mother, mamu holo, which is my elder mother, and mamane, my younger mother. So if you are a woman and you have a baby, your younger sister and your older sister also come into motherhood. They bear the roles and ethical responsibilities to do that. That's why we always say everybody's your mother, everybody's your child. You know, it's not biologically related. We often speak about black techs, you know,
yeah,
that we are responsible for people not because of a biological connection, but because of the ethical injunction of how our communities organize
and
themselves.
And this is, all of it is so closely related to the Islamic perspective, because mm-hmm. you speak about this ethical responsibility, which in Islam is the Ummah, you know. Mm-hmm. So the Prophet mm-hmm. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to the effect that if one part of the Ummah is hurting, the entire Ummah should feel the pain.
Yes.
And so that is how, if one part needs help, everybody must come to the to play a role in that.
Absolutely.
And that's why you see the strong affiliations of Muslims throughout. Whenever there's a struggle, Bosnia, Palestine, Kashmir, you see this rallying of the Muslim world, or Muslim majority countries, yes. but the Ummah per se. And then the other aspect that you speak of, and I'm really touched by that, where you spoke about the womb, because even in Islam, it's the rahim, you know, which we speak about, and that's where the child comes from, the rahim, from the womb, but it's closely connected with the name of Allah, which is Ar-Rahman, you know, which is the merciful name of God. So the mercy of the womb is linked to the mercy of God. And that connection also that you speak about in terms of the younger sister and the older sister, and sharing that perspective of motherhood, where the Prophet also said to the effect that the maternal aunt, which is your mother's sister, is like the mother. So the traditions are incredibly linked, as you can see. And of course, then it highlights the depth of community and involvement that every person plays, and that is not an individualistic society.
Absolutely. And we cannot take for granted the idiomatic and proverbs that are deep, not only in Muslim countries and in Arabic as a linguistic structure, which is born out of poetry, which is already from the onset configured as poetic and idiomatic, and so are African languages for that matter. So when they say it takes a village to raise a child, it is not merely something to titillate the colonialists with. It is truly, if we take it at its implication, at the veracity of that claim, that's what it means. It's not merely saying, oh, it takes a village to raise a child. It means that biology, the project of biology, dissipates. It means one is related to others because of where they're situated within the village, within the community, within the kinship. And I think this is one way in which we can launch a counterattack against the reduction of women to a biological category rather than to an ethical role. Motherhood, femininity, is not something that resides in a specific body, something that resides within a person. If, for instance, they will say only the male child may inherit from their father, but the work of Ifeanyi Madiyume has totally questioned those categories to say it may be so, but remember that the Nondi people believe that a chief is always a male, which means the firstborn child, whether biologically female or not, will be regarded as a male. And so then if it's a female, of course, they'll be chief, and they would marry other females, and the children born out of that would be born in the name of the female chief. And if the firstborn child is a woman, they were considered to be a man. So the statement only a male child may inherit from their father, it's not biological basis, which means somebody who is female could very well be the male and the father. So the category of father is not gender, is not biologically or physiologically or
anatomically. But it's about the role.
But it's about the role.
And the responsibility.
Exactly, but also about chronology. We organize our thing according to birth, according to the chronology of that. I mean, when twins are born, the one who comes out first is deemed to be the elder. You know, to have had the wisdom to usher that one into the world. So we don't abide by these chronological, you know, by this idea of a chronology that is Western and temporal and so on, you know. We give meaning to life, to action, to motion, you know. And so it's not like, oh, you were born first, now you are the number one. No, we think deeply about what does it mean to usher the first one into the world, you know. And that then creates the meaning of the stuff. And so father is the ethical category.
And
nothing
again,
to do.
It comes down to the whole concept of meaning. Mm-hmm. And so we have to go into a break, but I'm really pleased that you are raising one particular word a lot here, and that is the ethical, because it seems to have been eroded from our societies and from our understanding. But when we come back from the break, we'll talk a little further. We'll see you after the break.
بمديح الهادي تنتظم ضاءت بالمختار الظلم وحلا في مولده النغم.
Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah and welcome to the second segment of Finding Me today on the ITV networks with my very special guest, a colleague, an exceptional human being, Rantsho Moraka. And as we were speaking earlier, in the first segment, we spoke about the real issue of ethical responsibility and reigniting the ethical consciousness in order to understand how black societies were arranged, what the function was of that particular ethical concept in ordering the society and the eroding of the question of gender. Alfred, you know, before we went on to the break, you spoke about this giving of meaning. So father is literally just a literal term, and mother is a literal term which has become gender-based from the colonial conception. In the previous societies, I think the whole notion of father or the notion of mother basically resolved or revolved around that kind of responsibility which was associated with a particular organization of the society. So, for example, like you said, the mother could be the father if she was leading the tribe, etc., taking decisions. Does words and meanings play a very important role in black culture?
It's really crucial. It's really crucial to the I mean, Oyerenge's project, for instance, on gender, is a linguistic archaeological project. What she looks at is different translations, the way in which certain words in Yoruba culture were translated by the early anthropologists into gendered terms. You know, so her whole project is centered on listening to the oral stories about princesses and prince and children and chiefs and fathers, and saying, but none of the categories of these people were gendered. So when a Western anthropologist comes and say, I heard a story about a princess who got lost, blah, 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 what the gender was, the jury is still out. Because right. in the actual meaning, in the cultural thing, it was ungendered. We don't have gender pronouns, so it's possible for us to tell a billion tales without gender even being invoked. But somebody who comes to this society already carrying a gender order and a gender grammar can only interpret and convert those stories into gendered narratives. And that is what it happens.
So again, it comes back to what we were speaking about earlier, the censored worldview that now forces a mistranslation or a misinterpretation of the society, isn't it?
I actually think that's very critical for you to look at it like that, is that an African sense has been translated into a Western view, you know?
Exactly.
we go from sense, which is a much more capacious, holistic, biologically unrelated way of making, of giving account of the cosmology of the universe, to one that specifically demands gender be at the center of it. What's also interesting is that the West never understood us as gendered beings. They understood us as below humans, you know? When you study slavery in the United States, for those 300 years that our ancestors were enslaved, you will note that black people could not be raped. It was simply not. If a black woman was raped by the master, it was called seduction.
Wow. Okay.
Toni Morrison writes a book, A Beloved, which follows the killing of a mother killing her children before she sees them goes into slavery. But what ensues is a debate about whether they should be prosecuted for damage to property or for murder. Because they were not considered to be human beings. They were considered and taken to be object, you know, and their value, only the value of the weight of sugar, or whether you have a female horse or a male horse, but nobody would suggest that female horses are human being women, you know? And that's where black people are. We occupied the position of below human that was not gendered. So how we can now speak of ourselves in gendered language after encountering people who in their subjection of us did not even genderize us and understood us as incapable of doing that, as rapacious, as having the sexual stamina of animals that were uncontained, uncontrollable. And so the only differences that black people had when they said a black male and a black female, or a female nigger and a male nigger, was the same differences between blue cloth or expensive rum or expensive whiskey. It was not a gender distinction. It was a distinction in value of the object that we are seeing. This is a muscular, big object that's a male.
That can deliver more, maybe in terms of the plantation.
Absolutely.
And labor and stuff.
And labor,
like,
and so on. And this is the female object that can bear children and stuff like that. So we didn't even have reproductive integrity. Slaves were forced to sleep with each other all the time in order for them to appreciate the asset that is the property that they were. So gender has never formed part of our society whatsoever. Whether we're oppressed in the United States or pre-colonially before the whites reached here, there is no way in which we were implicated in the gender schema.
So is the obfuscation of this understanding of our societies prior to colonialism One of the reasons that has contributed to a total misunderstanding amongst our own people of their role, of the so-called genderedness within that has been made or formed into their consciousness by the colonial master, and the effect then thereof of this extreme violence that we see within our own society.
I think absolutely we have to think about it at that level, because this is divide and conquer. There is no way that we can find ourselves in the situation where we are, where a 92% majority suffers the horror, brutality, economically or otherwise, of an 8% minority. There is no way that this could happen without them multiplying themselves through making us the prosthetic versions of who they are. Speak our languages, English, believe in our God, you know, construct your families and kinship structures according to us, you know, and understand your relation to each other in terms of the way we understand ourselves, gendered relations. I mean, Quraysha, we have to ask ourselves, when the white master says to the white woman, I love you so much that when I die, you're gonna inherit all these niggas. What is the entity of the person being inherited? Is that person gendered? Can that person possibly be said to share any psychic or social structure to the person saying that they can be inherited? You know, I love my children so much that when they die, they're gonna get all these 92 niggas to do as they please with them. Unrapeable, because you can never rape them. Unmurderable, because you can only ever damage them.
So there's never any ethical accountability or accounting for the evil that you do for them.
Exactly, exactly.
Because you simply eliminate the possibility of doing harm.
Exactly, and even worse is that you don't enter their sociology, you know, because all you are in their world view is the object that is used in order for them to express to each other the love that they have to for each other. So when black people say to each other, I love you, it cannot possibly be the same I love you that a white master says to the white woman, because their I love you implicates you as an object of inheritance. Your I love you implicates us as a commitment to consciousness raising, to augmenting our spirit, to returning back to an order that would allow us to move through this catastrophe of whiteness.
It's interesting that you raise this, because at a recent talk that I went to, where Walter McNally was speaking about decolonial love, he also said, that, you know, amongst the other, love is different as amongst the white master, because he said, in the sense of, if you look at liberalism, love is so entwined with the economic, with the political, that it is about coming together, amassing together, earning together, and then of course taking from a lot of materiality from each other. And then when it doesn't work, that's why you find the exorbitant rate of divorces or single family marriages, etc., single parent families, etc., in Western society today, because they have lost that value or understanding of what love is. Love is not about ownership.
Yes. But I think you are raising an even more nuanced point, which is so lovely, because I never even thought of it like that, to say perhaps some of the struggles between so-called black men and black women is precisely because when we come together to form a romantic congress, it's not merely just the expressions of feeling. It is a political choice, whether we like it or not. It's a counter narrative against a historical injunction of who we should be. And I think that it's very critical to look at it in that way, that the weight of what, but also what's important is to say, since we're understood as object, what is the element of love? What happens when object love each other? What happens when objects refuse to be known as object and so transmogrify themselves in their own terms to things that can have categories of people that can have integrity? And that's why black love has to be transcendental, because it has to transcend the world in which it is an object. And so when we talk about black love, we are talking about black that is love that is out of this world, i.e. out of the white world, out of the white sociology, you know? So we love each other with an element that belongs to...
It's an extreme bond, right?
It's a deep, extreme bond, and a one that is central to our survival of the colonial condition we find ourselves, and one that also backdates itself to a time before white people came here, you know. So it's romantic, really, you know. It's deeply romantic in that way, and it's romantic not in the sense of roses and dinner, but romantic
it's
in the sense that
reimagining
it imagines, you know. So the romantic, perhaps we can insist on imagining it as that which delivers us to something higher understand the denigration and dishonor that
again,
we find
again
ourselves.
Again, you raise something from within Islamic culture, that even from the names of Allah is Al-Wadud, and then that is love, but there's also hope, which shows different kinds of love, you know, if you're looking at how to understand love. But we're at the end of this particular interview. We're going to come back with a second one and to talk about the Africanist posture and reimagining it. I just want to go out with a comment when Rantsho was speaking about this love and reimagining the love and speaking about the object and the possibility of the object to love. For many will say, how can an object love? Let's not forget from the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the tree on which he used to lean during every khutbah, how the tree cried when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, which shows that there's spirituality and a redefining of how we understand the object. So thank you for sharing this very, very thoughtful and insightful comment with me on gender on this Women's Day. And we'll come back next week. We'll talk about the Africanist posture, re-understanding it in terms of the decolonial narrative. So thanks, Rantsho. Fi amanillah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
قسما بالله رب العالمين ما ارتضينا غير دين الله دين فهو دين الحق دين الأنبياء إنه الإسلام نور وضياء
هذا الدر وهذه الكلم بمديح الهادي تنتظم ضياء